So Netflix did a Texas Chainsaw Massacre movie. Oh my, what rough beast slouches towards my retinas this day. In Texas Chainsaw Massacre 2022, we follow a group of social media influencers, which, to give this movie some credit, is one of the quickest and most efficient ways I've ever seen a slasher movie make you hate its characters. They make their way to an abandoned Texas town called Harlow, where they plan to sell off the old properties to a bunch of cosmopolitan city types and create a small progressive utopia, sort of like Galt's Gulch, but with a lot more Starbucks and homeless people shit. The group is led by Dante, the only black guy in the group and probably the most unlikable character in the whole film. Not because he's black, of course, but because he's a massive raging dickhead. From the moment we meet him, he's scoffing at locals and getting old ladies thrown out of their rightful property because they said something that offended him. I'm not kidding. When they speak to Ginny, an old lady who lives in a rundown orphanage, she claims that she still has the deed to the house, and when she comes out and says that she has no problem with Dante because she's looked after many boys like himself over the years, Dante throws a shit fit and gets the local Rozzos to force her out of the house. The stress of the whole thing causes her to die in an ambulance, and the big hulking dude who lives with her to go apeshit and kill the two police officers and Dante's fiancée who went along with them. Meanwhile, a busload of city slickers and Twitter tards show up for an auction of the properties within Harlow, and I'm currently in talks to trade my entire kingdom for a fucking drone strike. Lila, the tomboy of the group, strikes up a mild friendship with the most likable character in the film, Richter, a local mechanic and open Second Amendment rights advocate. Lila is revealed to be the survivor of a school shooting, giving her fear of guns most likely driving her gun control advocacy. It's actually an interesting character dynamic, which the film never really takes advantage of, but even then, it's yet more needless political commentary Netflix is intent on inserting into their movies. Upon hearing of Ginny's death via some text messages sent by Ruth, Dante's now late fiancée, Richter confiscates the keys to the orphanage and tells Dante he won't get them back until he proves he's got the deed to the place. Predictably, it turns out he doesn't, and they ultimately find the deed in Ginny's house, prompting us all to play the womp 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 sound effect in the collective soundtrack of our minds. Leatherface, being the embodiment of southern karma he is, mutilates Dante and leaves him bleeding to death out in the rain. Unfortunately, this also leads to the death of the best character, Richter, because this film hates me with every fibre of its being, apparently. Leatherface then proceeds to board the party bus filled with oblivious social media influencers who, in the height of satire, start live streaming their own gory deaths. After this, Sally Hardesty, the sole survivor of the first film and now grizzled Texas Ranger, shows up, allowing Lila and her sister Melody to get into her car. But instead of driving away, Sally gives us a nom speech, snatches up her shotgun, and starts after Leatherface because revenge and shit. But when she catches up with old Skinface and has him dead to rights at the end of her gun barrel, instead of just giving him the Lenny from Of Mice and Men treatment right then and there, she just talks to him and then lets him get up and walk away. This prompts an altercation where Sally is eventually gutted with a chainsaw, which didn't need to happen. Lila, now with the full opportunity to leave, is convinced to stay and hunt down Leatherface by a dying Sally, claiming that she will forever be haunted by him if she runs. Thanks, old dearie, but I'd rather be forever haunted than forever chainsawed. Lila, of course, goes a-hunting for the sadistic hillbilly. Leatherface gets uppercutted with his own chainsaw by Melody, leaving both to believe that the nightmare is finally over. Or is it? No, it's not. As the two roll away in some sort of self-driving car, Leatherface reappears and pulls Melody out of the vehicle. Lila sticks her head up through the sunroof and watches her sister be decapitated as the car slowly and hilariously rolls away, with Lila screaming like a banshee in a mockery of the original's ending. First, the good stuff. It's well shot, quite colourful, and the performances and gore aren't bad. It doesn't try to mimic the style of the original, except in the opening where a documentary about the original killings airs on a TV in a convenience store in bumfuck nowhere. For that, they even get John Larroquette to voice the narrator just like in the original. It's actually a nice little touch and it's appreciated. The film even manages to insert a couple of interesting characters in there with Richter, the gun-toting local mechanic, and Lila, the mousy tomboy school-shooting survivor. While some might cringe at the needless insertion of modern social issues into a slasher flick, and I did, both characters are treated with a bit of humanity, and their interactions don't degenerate into a contrived shouting match despite their diametrically opposed worldviews, with Richter even being sympathetic towards Lila after finding out about her past. You can sort of tell this wasn't written by Americans, is what I'm saying. Unfortunately, just about everyone else is completely insufferable, and yeah, I know, slasher movies don't have real characters, they have Special Olympics contenders of the type that try to eat the cool, shiny candies inside the starting pistol, But you can have characters be stupid without being annoying, and most of these people are not only annoying, but not particularly good people either. The film is surprisingly non-woke at times with its obvious disdain towards social media influencers, but its commentary is predictably wielded the same way Leatherface wields his chainsaw, wildly and subtly and with very little direction or goal. As a result, when Leatherface boards the party bus and is immediately threatened with being cancelled, I cringe more than I laugh. I'm not even against chainsaw movies having some comedy in them either. Texas Chainsaw Massacre 2 is filled with ridiculous comedy, and even the almost documentary style original had a few dark laughs thrown in, but this one has neither the black mirth of the original nor the absurdity of the second film. Among the worst aspects is the addition of the Sally Hardesty character from the original film, played by Irish actress. It's not really that she does a bad job, and more that her character is underwritten and completely irrational. They were obviously going for their own version of the recent Halloween movie's take on Laurie Strode's character, but without nearly the commitment to the character that those movies provided. To some extent, at least. Her dialogue is almost entirely back-and-nom, thousand-yard stare nonsense, and when she does eventually get the chance to kill Leatherface, she doesn't do it, leading to her getting chainsawed to death. She's pretty much nothing as a character and could have been completely cut out. Had she been cut out, then this would have only contributed to this film's one other positive aspect. The fact that it's short. Seriously, it's only about 73 minutes long if you cut out the very stylized end credits. It makes me wonder if stuff was cut out due to a supposedly terrible test audience feedback. But really, this film being about 10 minutes shorter than what it already is honestly wouldn't be to its detriment. It kills off its only truly likable character very early on, and we're left with two waifish women with very little personality. Lila may have an intriguing backstory, but she doesn't make for a very convincing hero. Even her arc surrounding her fear of guns doesn't even pan out into anything cool or interesting. It's got some good gore effects, it's well shot, and it's mercifully short, but I don't think this really makes it worth it. It's not even one of those reimaginings that insults the original so much that it raises my hackles. I was able to predict pretty much everything that happens in the film with relative accuracy as well. If you want to check out just for the Instagram massacre on the bus, then go right ahead, but outside of that, it's not really worth anyone's time. If you have Netflix and plenty of booze, then check it out. If not, you're not missing much. I'm DeadEye, and may you ride the night to the morning sun.